Like we were discussing about the not yesterday, day before yesterday. Yesterday we had full revision, right? So day before yesterday we were discussing about the two different growth model. That is, one is the exponential growth pattern we discussed, and the second one is the logistic growth pattern, right? So in exponential growth pattern, this type of growth pattern usually occurs. This type of growth pattern usually occurs when there are unlimited resources. And then in the predator-free environment, then if the organism is having good biotic potential, that is the reproductive potential of the organism will be very high. Okay. In all these situations, the exponential growth of population will happen. And we will be analyzing a graph or plotting a graph against population, that is number of individuals and the time t. Okay. So if you draw a graph for this, then you will get a J-shaped curve for this exponential growth population pattern. And the equation is dN by dt is equal to B minus D into N. So B minus D can be replaced by R. Okay. So you have the final equation dN by dt is equal to RN. So N represents the number of individuals, that is the population size. Then T represents the time taken, and then B, birth rate, D is the death rate, and finally B minus DR, it is the change in population size, whether increase or decrease during a unit time period, okay? And R is the one which is called as the intrinsic rate of natural increase. It can also be called as the biotic potential of the organism that indicates the impact of biotic and abiotic factors in the population growth, okay? Right? So this is regarding your exponential growth. And coming to the logistic growth occurs when there are limited resources, and if there is competition between the organisms for that limited resource and predators will be present in the environment. In all these cases, we have this logistic growth pattern, and this logistic growth pattern, it will give a curve called as S-shaped growth curve. That is what we call it as sigmoid-shaped growth curve. Okay. And in the sigmoid-shaped growth curve, the population will attain three different phases. Initially, it will attain the lag phase, then followed by that, the phase of acceleration or deceleration will be there, which we call it as a log phase, okay, L-O-G. Initially, you will get L-A-G, lag phase. Then you will get the log phase. And finally, when it reaches the carrying capacity of the environment, it attains the stage of stationary phase or asymptote phase or plateau phase, okay. And here the equation is dN by dt is equal to RN into K minus N by K. So please, K minus N by K, I told you K minus N by K. This should be written in bracket, okay? So it can also be written as 1 minus N by K. K by K minus N by K. K by K is 1 minus N by K. So this represents environmental resistance. This whole equation 1 minus N by K or K minus N by K, it represents the environmental resistance. So what do you mean by environmental resistance? The day I told you, but I didn't give you the definition, right? So you can write the definition of this environmental resistance. The environmental resistance, how can you define is the factors like natural calamities, and then the predators, then outbreak of diseases, outbreak of epidemic disease or pandemic diseases, okay? So all these will happen to decrease the population. Outbreak of diseases, and then if there are limited resources, there will be shortage of resources. Because of competition between the organisms, there will be shortage of resources, right? Etc. Or you can see like so many factors like this. All these factors which always impose a check on the population. Which impose means that will be always like forcing. These factors, it always imposes a check on the population. Check on the population means like they will be always checking whether the population is stable or not. If they find it like the population is like beyond the carrying capacity, again, the stability will be maintained by all these factors. So this impose on check on population, it forms the environmental resistance. So if environmental resistance, they are asking you to define, you can write this definition, okay? The factors like calamities. Calamities means natural disaster, like cyclone, flood, tsunami, landslide, earthquake, whatever it is, okay? And then predators which are prevailing in the environment. Outbreak of epidemic and pandemic diseases. Shortage of resources. All these factors which impose a check on population, they form the environmental resistance. And this environmental resistance can be represented as 1 minus n by k or k minus n divided by k. Okay, fine. And you know what is k here? K is the carrying capacity of what? Carrying capacity of what? Tell me. K is said to be the carrying capacity of dash. Please give your answers. Nature. Yeah, you can say nature, but the exact term that should be used is environment, okay? K is called as the carrying capacity of environment. The day itself I told you, right? Carrying capacity of the environment means you can write the definition of this carrying capacity also. Carrying capacity can be defined as the maximum number of individuals. It is the maximum number of individuals which the environment can, I'll write here, which the environment can support. The maximum number of individuals the environment can support is called as the carrying capacity. That's what I told you, an example. So in your class, only it can accommodate 50 students, and that is the carrying capacity of that particular room, okay? Similarly, you have carrying capacity for each and every environment. So the maximum number of individuals which the environment can support, and that is what we call them as a carrying capacity of environment, which can be represented by the letter called as K. Okay. So this is what we discussed that day. And I just want to tell you some three components. The carrying capacity of the environment depends upon three components. Okay. You just write the K value. K, you know what is K? It is the carrying capacity of the environment. The K value depends upon three components. K depends upon three components. The carrying capacity of environment depends upon three components. Let me tell you what are the three components. The first one is the productive system. Productive system. See, by the term itself, productive. Productive means productivity. Who are producers in the environment? Mostly the plants, right? So plants are called as the producers because they are all autotrophs and they can synthesize their own food. Animals are not called as producers. They are all called as consumers, right? So productive system means it includes the plants. The plants which provide food for us, okay? The plants which provide food and fibers. Carrying capacity of the environment depends upon the productive system. The second component is going to be protective system. So what is meant by protective system? Protective system, it includes the forest, ocean, etc. Why these factors are called as protective system? Because they all regulate the temperature and humidity of the environment, which regulates temperature and humidity. Okay, the environmental factors will be decided by these factors. So they are called as the protective system. And the third component is the one what we call it as waste assimilative system. The third component is waste assimilative system. Any idea about waste assimilative system? It includes the generation of waste material. You know, decomposers are present in the soil, right? So these decomposers are degrading the dead decaying plants and animals after their death. So the generation of waste material in water, air and soil, all these abiotic factors, the generation of waste material. So these are the three different components, like where your carrying capacity of the environment, which is represented as K, will depends upon. So this is also a very important question. So please mark it as important. That's all about your growth model. Your growth model ends up here. So under growth model, I'll just consolidate everything. So under growth model, what are the things you discussed? Basically, the growth model or population growth pattern can be of two types, right? One is the exponential growth and second one is the logistic growth. We discussed about under what factors they will occur and what is the graph, what is the curve you will get it, and then finally the equation we derived it, okay? So by using this equation, we came to know about carrying capacity of the environment, and other one is the environmental resistance, okay? So carrying capacity of the environment is the maximum number of individuals which the environment can support. And the other one is the environmental resistance are usually the natural factors. All these factors will impose a check on the population, which forms the environmental resistance. Okay. And the last concept is the carrying capacity of the environment depends upon three important components. The first one is the productive system, which we call it as the plants which provide food and fibers. And second one is the protective system that includes the forest, ocean, etc., which regulates the temperature and humidity of the environment. And third one is the waste assimilative system, that is the generation of waste material in water, air and soil. Fine. So you please copy these two slides, students. Then we can move on to the last topic in your population level. So this is the last topic. With this topic, this chapter will get over. Okay. So still we have 15 minutes. So we can discuss this topic for 15 more minutes. Then by sharp 9 o'clock, we can start the revision. Waste assimilation. Waste assimilation is nothing but the waste material that is generated in the air, water and soil. See, suppose if you take soil, so what is the waste material? Whatever the domestic garbage, industrial waste and all we are dumping in the soil, right? They are all waste materials. And these waste materials will be assimilated. Assimilated means they will be digested and then used up by the decomposers. And that's why you just think of the environment without decomposers. Without decomposers, how will your environment be? All the waste materials will be dumped and there will be no cycling of nutrients, right? No biogeochemical cycle happens. And there will be the next generation of organisms cannot survive in the environment, okay? Only if the waste materials are assimilated, the environment will be free for space and nutrients will be cycled again and again. Only if all these things happen, the next generation organisms can survive in the particular environment. And that is called as waste assimilative system. Got it? Got it? Yes. Pragadish, are you able to understand now? Yeah, I'll show you the first slide. So I'm showing the first two slides. You please copy, then we can move on to the next topic. So please write the definition, students. Please note down the definition of this environmental resistance and carrying capacity of environment. It will not be there in your NCERT properly. They won't give you the proper definition will not be there. But in your board exams, they may ask you to write about what is the environmental resistance or what is carrying capacity of environment. See. Finally, if you want to conclude which one of the growth model or growth pattern is a stable one or a realistic one, can you answer exponential growth or logistic growth? Which among these two growth pattern is the stable one? Which can protect the environment, which can maintain the ecological balance? Yes, it is obviously logistic growth. Okay, exponential growth, no, it always affects the environment. It always disturbs the population. It causes ecological imbalance. So many drawbacks are there in exponential growth. Okay. But in logistic growth, it is not like that. When it is always maintaining the stability, as soon as it reaches the carrying capacity of the environment, it is said to be the realistic one and it is also the stable one. Okay. This is the second slide. Have you all copied? Shall we move on to the next topic? I'll just give you the introduction. This topic in detail we can discuss on Monday. It is not possible to complete within 15 minutes. I'll just give you what you're going to study in this last topic. So the last topic under your population level. So under population level, can you recall what are the things you studied? First, you studied what are the different attributes related to population. Under that, we discussed about birth rate, death rate, life expectancy, lifespan, what is population size, what is population growth, population density. Then we discussed about age, sex structure, age distribution pyramid, all those things. Okay. The second concept what you discussed is about the growth of population. That is the growth model of population. Under that, we studied about exponential growth pattern and logistic growth pattern. And now the third topic is population interaction. Okay. So what do you mean by population interaction? So first I'll tell you in theory, then I'll tell you what are the things you are going to discuss here. See, if you take the nature, you know, whichever habitat you take, both biotic and abiotic factors will be present, right? So far what we discussed in the organism level, what are the things we discussed? What are the different abiotic factors and how organisms will adapt to the environmental factor, right? So based on that, you classify the organism into confirmers, regulators, and partial regulators. Then we discussed what are the different adaptations that will be present in the organisms. For example, if you take xerophytic plants, how it will adapt to a desert region. And if we go to polar regions, how the animals will adapt to the polar region. So like this, we discussed the different adaptation of the organism, right? Now in the population interaction, what you are going to see, how the interaction is going to be there among the organisms, among the living organisms, okay? Here we are not going to discuss about the interaction of living with non-living. Here we are going to discuss how the living organism itself, they are going to be interdependent within each other. In nature, if you say in nature, no species can survive alone. No species can survive independently. No species can survive in isolation. Each of the plant species, animal species, somewhere or other, they have to depend upon other organisms. If at all, the ecological pyramid cannot sustain. Okay. Even if you take the plant species, which can synthesize their own food, they cannot survive alone. And why I am telling like plant species cannot survive alone. They cannot, how they are dependent on other living organisms. You just think of microorganisms are not there in the soil. Okay. How do the plant get the nutrients from the soil? Only because of microorganisms, the nutrients present in the soil are replenished again and again, right? So plants, even they are autotrophs, they can synthesize their own food, they cannot survive alone. They need the soil microorganisms to break down the organic matter in the soil. And that's why the organic matter will be returned to the soil in the form of inorganic nutrients, okay? So besides, plant also need animals. How plant is dependent on animals? You studied in sexual reproduction in flowering plants. How plants are dependent on animals? Can you tell me? How plants are dependent on animals? Yes, very good. For pollination. Okay. So for pollination, plants are dependent on insects. Plants are dependent on some other animals for pollination. Like in nature, plants, animals, microbes, no living organism can live independently. Okay. Living organisms depend on one another for their survival. Okay. So plants, animals, microorganisms, all of them, like they cannot live independently. They cannot live in isolation. They interact in different ways to form the biological community. Okay. And that is what we are going to discuss under this topic, the interspecific association. So what you are going to study in this population interaction is the interspecific associations. What do you mean by interspecific association? Inter means in between. Okay. Specific means in between two different species, there will be some association. This interspecific association arises from how this association means they are like joined up together. Okay. So this interspecific associations arise from the interaction of population of different species of organisms. Population of different species. When different species of population of organisms interact with one another, their interspecific associations will arise. These association, we are going to study about this interspecific association. Now these associations, right, interspecific association, I told you, like they are having some relationship between them. And that relationship can be of three different things. It can be either beneficial to one another, or sometimes it can be harmful. This harmful can also be called by the term detrimental. Detrimental, harmful, both are same. Suppose if a parasite is living in a host body, will it give any beneficial things to the host? No, it will get beneficial things from the host, but in return, what it will do? It will give diseases to the host. So sometimes the association may be harmful, or sometimes it may be neutral. Neutral means it is neither beneficial nor harmful. Neither beneficial nor harmful. In human health and disease, I told you one organism, it will be neutral. You remember? Entamoeba coli, I told you, right? It is a neutral organism. It will not cause you any effect in your body. Neither it will not give you any beneficial to your human organism. So these are the three different associations we are going to discuss. And these associations can be indicated, the different interspecific associations can be represented by symbols. The different interspecific association, this association can also be called as interactions. Okay, the different interspecific associations or interactions, no? It can be indicated as plus, minus, zero. Plus means it represents the beneficial. Minus means it represents harmful or detrimental. And zero is neutral, neither beneficial nor harmful. Okay, so these are the three different symbols that will be used for indicating this. Indicates this plus indicates beneficial, minus indicates harmful, zero indicates neutral. Okay, so under this concept, we are going to discuss six different interactions between the organisms. I will tell you what are the six different interactions, and we can discuss about these six different interactions in detail on Monday. Okay, so what are the six different interactions? You just write it in a table. The first column, you write name of interaction. The second one, you write species. Two different organisms will interact, right? One is species A, another one is species B. Fine. So first type of interaction is parasitism. You know parasitism. A parasite will dependent on host. So let species A be parasite and species B host. Okay. Or species A be host or species B parasite. One of them will be beneficial and other one will be affected. Who will be beneficial? Parasite will be beneficial because it is taking food, shelter, everything from the host. But host will be affected by the parasite. So I am putting minus, harmful. Okay. Now the second one is the best known thing. I will tell you the first known things, then I will tell you the other things. Mutualism. You know, in mutualism, both the organisms are mutually benefited, right? So I can put plus for both the organism. Third one is predation. In predation, the predator will eat the prey. Predator will be benefited. Prey will be affected. Okay. The species A, B can be anything. You can put minus here, plus also here. Okay. It is not like always plus in species A and minus in species B. Okay. Now the fourth one is predation, you know. Right. Now I will tell you the new things. Commensalism. Commensalism. In commensalism, one organism will be benefited, the other organism will be neutral, zero. Amensalism. Like commensalism, you have amensalism. In amensalism, one organism will be harmful, that is, it will be affected, and other one will be neutral. And the last one is competition. Okay, competition. In competition, both the organisms will be affected. Minus, minus. Both will be minus. Okay. So these are the six different population interactions. So you are these. It is the population interaction we are going to discuss. We will discuss all the six interactions. I will tell you what is meant by parasitism. I'll give you some examples also. Like this, we will discuss all the six different population interactions in the forthcoming classes. That is, I will start discussing on Monday. Monday we can discuss 3 and Tuesday we can discuss 3. We can complete within 2 days. This chapter will get over. This is the last concept. And one student asked me, like, under organism level, like abiotic factors and biotic factors, you said, ma'am, but only you discussed about abiotic factors. Biotic factor is not there in your, in this part, okay? And actually, biotic factor is nothing but the living organism. That is what you are studying in biology from your 6th class, okay? Biotic factor separately is not there in the syllabus, okay? So we will not be discussing about biotic factors separately. Only what are the abiotic factors and how organisms will interact with the abiotic factors. Yes, last 2 more minutes, I will show you all the slides, students. So first one, second one, I think already you have copied so many times. No, symbiotic and mutualism are same. Symbiotic, you can represent mutualism as symbiotic relationship also. Both are same only. Yes, I'll show you from the third slide, ma'am. This is third one. So third, fourth, and fifth slide, I'll show you now. You please copy. We have only 2 more minutes. We shall start the discussion by sharp by 9 o'clock. This is the third one. First slide, wait, I will show you. Third slide, have you all copied? Fourth one. Please draw this table, ma. This will be the overall thing of this concept, full concept population interaction. Okay. Okay. So some students asked me to show the first slide. This is first slide. Yeah, wait. Second one. Third one. Fourth one. This is fourth one. The last one. Okay, shall I close this window? Shall we go for the revision part? Okay, 25 students are there, students. So totally I have taken 25 questions. So please write the answers fast, okay? Or else it is not possible to complete in half an hour. I'll show you first 5 questions now. We'll go 5 by 5, okay? First you write the answers, then I will start discussing for that 5, then I will show you the next 5. Yes, so this is the first question. Mark the answer for the first question. Finished writing first, second one. The second question. Third one. This is match the following. Fourth one. Fifth one. This is the last question. Yes, Ganesh, thank you so much for the information. Yeah, let's wait. No problem. First, let us discuss with the remaining chapters. We don't want to concentrate in the deleted portion, right? Then, after completing the remaining chapters, we can discuss about those chapters, right? Okay, finish writing? Yes. Now go to the first question. Listen, which one of the following is the correct statement regarding the particular psychotropic drug specified? They are asking us to mark the correct statement, right? Now read the first statement. Morphine leads to delusions and disturbed emotions. Okay. Morphine leads to delusion. Illusion and delusion will be caused by hallucinogens. Morphine comes under opiate narcotics. Okay, so it will not cause delusion and disturbed emotion because it is narcotic in the sense, then it is going to calm down. It will not cause us disturbed emotion. Okay, so this statement is wrong. Second one, barbiturates causes relaxation and temporary euphoria. Euphoria will be caused by opiate narcotics and not barbiturates. Okay, so again the second statement is also wrong. Barbiturates comes under sedative, right? Hashish is a hallucinogen. It causes afterthought perception and hallucination. Yes, it is right. Opium stimulates the nervous system and causes hallucination. Opium is not a hallucinogen. Also, it will not stimulate the nervous system because it is a narcotic. It is not a stimulant. Only stimulant will stimulate the nervous system. So, the correct statement is option C. Okay. Now, the second question. To which type of barriers under innate immunity do the saliva in the mouth and the tears from the eyes belong? So all these secretions belong to your, they are physical barriers. Physical barriers are skin and mucous membrane. Okay, cellular barriers comes under your WBC, all your phagocytes and other WBC cells. Cytokine barriers are interferons, interleukins, IL, cytokines, lymphokines, etc. Okay. Then they are said to be physiological barriers because all the secretions in your body comes under your physiological barrier. Okay. Now the third one, match the disease in column one with the appropriate item. It can be pathogen, prevention, treatment, something relating to that. Okay. Amoebiasis, you know, what is amoebiasis? Amoebiasis is amoebic dysentery. whenever we get dysentery, our body will get dehydrated. So use only, yes, it is caused by contaminated food and water, so it can be sterilized food and water. Diphtheria, Cornibacterium diphtheriae, yes. So the vaccine that is given is DPT vaccine. So diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, cholera. So in cholera, there will be rice water stool, okay? No, amoebiasis, you can go use oral rehydration therapy. And cholera, you can see only sterilized food and water. Syphilis is a sexually transmitted disease which is caused by Treponema pallidum. So option A is D, okay? And then second one, diphtheria. Diphtheria is DPT vaccine. That is not D, it is 4. B is 2. C, cholera. B is 3. C is 2. And D, syphilis is 1. So which is the correct answer? 1, 2, 3, 4 in the reverse order. Option A. Option A is the right answer. Then the fourth question. Use of antihistamines and steroids. Antihistamines and steroids will be given to have a quick relief from allergy. Yes, we studied in allergic case, inflammation will be there, and the inflammation will be caused by the release of histamines and serotonins by your mast cells. Okay, and to reduce the histamine secretion, antihistamines and steroids will be given. So answer is D. Which one of the following statement is correct? We should mark the correct one. Benign tumor show the property of metastasis. Benign tumor will not show the property of metastasis. It is malignant tumor. Heroin accelerates body function. Heroin is a narcotic. It is not a stimulant. So it will not accelerate the body function. Malignant tumor may exhibit metastasis. Yes, malignant tumor may exhibit metastasis. Malignant tumor can spread either by two conditions, either by invasion method or by metastasis method. Okay. So here it will cause by like a malignant tumor may exhibit the metastasis condition. So it is correct. And the last option you can see, patients who have undergone surgery are given cannabinoids to relieve the pain. Yes, cannabinoid derivatives, right? Cannabinoids will cause hallucination. Hallucinogen compounds will not be given for relieving pain. So the correct one is option C. Okay, fine. Now I will give you the next five questions. Six, seven, eight, nine, 10. Okay, this is the sixth question, ma. Sixth question. Finished sixth, seventh one. The seventh question. Eighth one. No. You need not to answer in the chat. This is eighth one. This is ninth one. Ninth question.
Yeah, finished writing 9th, 10th one. This is 10th. Finished? Yeah, this question, some students are asking me doubt. See, actually, this amoebiasis, you will have dysentery, right? In dysentery, there will be severe dehydration and you can go for oral rehydration therapy. Okay. At the same time, in cholera also, rice water stool will be there and for that also, they will give oral rehydration therapy. So, if you go for the option like this, A is like only sterilized food and water because that organism will be present in the contaminated food and water. Okay. A2, B, diphtheria, DPT vaccine, B3, C, cholera, oral rehydration therapy, and D, syphilis 1. Okay. 2, 3, 4, 1. That option is also there. I think better we can go to this option. I thought this option will not be there. That's why I choose this option. Like it is like perfect if we go for amoebiasis, sterilized food and water, and cholera, ORT, that is oral rehydration therapy. You go for this option B, A2, B3, C4, D1. Better than going for A, okay? Because in both the cases, dehydration will be there, and both the cases, oral rehydration therapy will be given. Okay, now coming to question number 6. A person likely to develop tetanus is immunized by administering. So for tetanus, I told you, right, whenever we get injury or wound, that TT will be given. Tetanus toxoid vaccine will be given. Okay. So this is said to be an artificially synthesized antibody. So what do you mean by this? Artificially synthesized antibodies are called as, they are called as preformed antibodies. Okay. Antibiotics will not be given. Antibiotics will be given to kill the bacteria or to inhibit the growth of bacteria. Weakened germs will be given in vaccine. In vaccine, they will give either the partially attenuated or partially killed vaccines. Organisms will be used, which we call it as weakened organism. And dead organisms can also be sometimes used in vaccines. In vaccines, either they will use dead organisms or partially killed or attenuated weakened organisms will be used in vaccines. Okay, so these three will not be used in tetanus. It is preformed antibodies. This comes under what immunity? Can you tell me? Preformed antibodies are active immunity or passive immunity? Yes, active. Active means what I told you. Active is directly your body will be developing the production of antibody. Okay, it is passive. It is not active. Passive. Fine. Now coming to the 7th question. Select the correct statement. We have to select the correct statement. So first one, read, barbiturates when given to criminals, make them tell the truth. Barbiturate is a sedative, okay? It will not make the criminal to tell the truth. It will make them to sleep, actually. If you give barbiturates to the criminal, they will sleep. Then second one, morphine is often given to persons who have undergone surgery as a painkiller. Yes, because morphine is an opiate narcotic, and opiate narcotic can act as an analgesic, as a pain reliever, so it can be given. Chewing tobacco lowers the blood pressure and heart rate? No, it will not lower. It will increase. Tobacco, it acts as a stimulant, right? Whenever your stimulant is taken, it will not lower the blood pressure. It will increase the blood pressure and heartbeat rate. Okay. Cocaine. What is cocaine? Cocaine is a stimulant. Okay. Given to patients after surgery, it stimulates recovery? No, it will stimulate the nervous system and it will make your mind, body, brain to be active, right? So the correct one is option B. See, when they are giving you statement like this, first you just mark by the side whether it is correct statement or wrong statement. Then go to the question, see what they have been asking you. Whether they are asking you to choose the correct one or wrong one, then you mark the answer. Okay, sometimes you will not read the question properly, and you will, like, they will be asking you to select the correct one and you will be selecting the wrong one. Okay, so you will do mistakes like this. So please be clear and please highlight the word, what, whether it is correct or wrong statement to be selected. Okay, then the eighth question: which one of the following statement is correct with respect to AIDS? The first one: HIV can be transmitted through eating food together with an infected person. No, not at all, right? The drug addicts are least susceptible to HIV infection. They are not least susceptible. They are highly susceptible. So this is also wrong. AIDS patients are being fully cured 100% with proper care and nutrition. There is no complete treatment for this AIDS. The causative HIV retrovirus, it enters the helper T lymphocytes and reducing their number. Yes, obviously it is correct. It reduces the count of helper T cell and thereby the production of antibodies will be affected. Okay, so option D is the right one. Then the ninth question: consider the following four statements regarding kidney transplant and select the two correct ones out of these. So we have to select the two. Actually, here option should be there, but those options are not there. But anyways, we will select the two correct statements. Okay, even if a kidney transplant is proper, the recipient may need to take immunosuppressants for a long time. Yes, they need to take immunosuppressants because sometimes the rejection may occur. So to prevent the graft rejection, immunosuppressant will be given to the recipient even after the post-surgery period. Okay, the cell-mediated immune response is responsible for the graft rejection. Cell-mediated immune response is given by T cells. T cells are the maximum, 80%. They are responsible for the graft rejection. The B lymphocytes are responsible for the graft rejection? Wrong. B lymphocytes provides what type of immunity? It is called as humoral immunity, or it is called as antibody mediated immunity. This is not responsible. The acceptance of graft rejection of a kidney transplant depends upon specific interferons. This is also wrong. Interferons will be acting in our body only for against the viral particle. That's why it is called as antiviral glycoprotein. Kidney rejection, graft rejection will not be done by the interferons. So the two correct statements are A and B. If there is an option with A and B correct statement, then that should be the correct answer. Okay. Then, where will you look for the sporozoids of the malarial parasite? You know, the infective stage of the Plasmodium is sporozoid. Red blood corpuscles of humans suffering from malaria, in the RBCs, it will not be in the stage of sporozoid. It will turn to some other stage. You studied the different stages, you remember? Then spleen of infected human. No. Salivary glands of the freshly molted female Anopheles mosquito. Yes, actually in the salivary glands of the mosquito, but not in the freshly molted. Freshly molted means the one that has turned into an adult organism. You know what is molting process? You would have studied in cockroach, molting. Molting means during metamorphosis, it will attain some stages. And each of this process is called as molting process. Okay. Saliva of the infected female Anopheles mosquito. Yes, it is correct. It will be present in the saliva of the infected. Because once the organism enters into the mosquito, it will reach the gut. There it will undergo fertilization. Then it will change into oocinet. And from there, it will be transported to the salivary gland. And there it will be stored before the sporozoid will be finally present in the saliva of the infected female Anopheles mosquito. D is the correct answer. Okay. Now I will give you the next five questions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, this is the 11th question, ma. Students, please fast. Time is 9:20. We have 10 more minutes. Okay, shall I directly discuss the answer? See, the pathogen Microsporum responsible for ringworm disease in human belongs to the same kingdom of organism. Microsporum belongs to fungi. Okay, we studied three different genera of fungi, right? Microsporum, Epidermophyton, Trichodermophyton. All these belongs to kingdom fungi. Now, which one is kingdom fungi? Tinea, tapeworm, it belongs to Platyhelminthes. Uchereria filarial worm, it belongs to Aschelminthes. Rhizopus is a fungi, it belongs to kingdom fungi. Ascaris, again Platyhelminthes. Then which one is the Same kingdom of organism, option C. Okay. The 12th one. Which one of the following gives the correct matching of the disease with its causative organism and mode of infection? See the first one, typhoid, Salmonella typhi with inspired air. Typhoid is the mode of infection is inspired air. It is because of contaminated food and water. So it is wrong. Pneumonia, Streptococcus pneumoniae, correct. Droplet infection, yes, correct. Elephantiasis, Urticaria bancrofti, it is not because of infected food and water. It is because of the female bite of female Culex mosquito. So this is also wrong. Malaria, Plasmodium vivax, bite of not male. It is female Anopheles mosquito. So the correct one is option B. Okay. 13th question. Select the correct statement with respect to diseases and immunization. If due to some reason, B, you have to select the correct statement. B and T lymphocytes are damaged. The body will not produce antibodies against a pathogen. Yes, correct. Injection of dead or inactivated pathogen causes passive immunity. Injection of dead or inactivated pathogen. No, it will not. It is a dead or inactivated pathogen. Is no, it is a vaccine. It is not passive immunity. Okay. If vaccination comes under active immunity. Certain protozoans have been used in mass production of hepatitis B vaccine. No, hepatitis B is caused by virus, not by protozoa. Injection of snake antivenom against snake bite is an example of active immunization. It is a passive immunization. So the correct statement is option A. Which one of the following human organ is called the graveyard of RBC? This is a direct question. You know spleen. Spleen is the graveyard of RBCs because RBCs after its lifespan, it will go and destruct in the spleen. Which one of the following organism is scientifically correctly named, correctly printed according to the international rules of nomenclature and correctly described? Plasmodium falciparum, a protozoan pathogen causing the most serious type of malaria. Yes, correct. Then, Felis tigris, the Indian tiger, well protected in Gir forest. It is not Gir forest. You will study about this in biodiversity chapter. Okay. E. coli, full name Entamoeba coli, a common occurring bacterium in human intestine. It is not Entamoeba coli. It is Escherichia coli. Again, this is also wrong. Then in here also, it is not Felis tigris. It is Panthera tigris. Genus name is also wrong and Gir forest is also wrong. Musca domestica, the common house lizard. It is not house lizard. Musca domestica is house fly. It is not house lizard. Okay. So the correct one is option A. Okay. Now 16th question. See the 16th question, ma. Which one of the following statement is correct with respect to immunity? We have to select the correct one. The antibodies against smallpox pathogen are produced by T lymphocytes. Will T lymphocytes produce the antibodies? No, it is B lymphocytes. That's why the immunity is called as antibody mediated immunity. T lymphocytes will not produce the antibodies. Okay, they are involved in graft rejection. Antibodies are protein molecules, each of which has four light chain. This is correct, but not four light chain. They have only two light chain. Two light chain and two heavy chain. Rejection of a kidney graft is the function of B lymphocyte. It is not B lymphocyte, it is T lymphocyte. Preformed antibodies need to be injected to treat the bite of a viper snake. Yes, anti-snake venom. It is correct. Option D. In which one of the following options, the two examples are correctly matched particular type of immunity? See, cellular barrier, polymorphonuclear leukocytes and monocytes. Yes, it is correct. Active immunity, anti-tetanus, anti-snake. They both are not active. They both are passive. Physical barriers, saliva in mouth and tears are not physical. They are physiological. Physiological barrier, mucus coating. Yes, mucus coating is not physiological. It is physical. So the correct one is option A. 18th question. Infection of Ascaris usually occurs by drinking water containing eggs of Ascaris. You know what is the disease caused by Ascaris? It is ascariasis. It is because of the contaminated food and water. Okay. Eating imperfectly cooked pork? No. CC fly? No. Mosquito bite. Drinking water containing this eggs of Ascaris. That is the right answer. What is this plant? Anybody have idea? What is this name of the plant? What is the name of this plant? Yes, very good. It is hemp. Okay. So, sorry. It is datura, right? So, it comes under what? Hallucinogen. A. Which of the following immunoglobulin does constitute the largest percentage in human milk? In human milk, which immunoglobulin will be present in high amount? IgA. It is B. IgA. Okay. Yeah, we have 5 more questions. Let me complete that also. Oh, those all are simple questions. I'll finish it off in 2 minutes, students. Please wait for me. Okay. The 21st question. Asthma may be attributed by, asthma is because of the allergic reaction of the mast cells in the lungs, because asthma is an allergic disorder. It is not a bacterial infection. It is not inflammation of trachea or accumulation of fluid. Asthma in the sense, it is allergic disorder. Okay. In higher vertebrates, the immune system can distinguish self and non-self. If this property is lost due to genetic abnormality and it attacks the self cell, then it leads to autoimmune disease. Okay. Autoimmune disease is because of your natural killer cells are not able to differentiate yourself and non-self. Okay. Anti-venom injection contains preformed antibody, while polio drops that are administered. Polio drop is a vaccine. Vaccine contains dead or attenuated pathogen. So option D. Okay. Which of the following is correct regarding AIDS? HIV is enveloped virus, yes, correct. That contains 2 identical molecules of a single stranded RNA, correct, and 2 molecules of reverse transcriptase. All are correct. HIV is unenveloped, no, envelope will be present. HIV does not escape but attacks the acquired immune response. HIV escape, okay. HIV is enveloped virus containing 1 molecule of single stranded is wrong. It is 2 molecule and 2 molecule of reverse transcriptase. So option A is the correct one. Malt constitute about dash of the present of the lymphoid tissue, 50%. What is malt? Mucus associated lymphoid tissue. Okay, so it comes under your secondary lymphoid organ and it accounts for about 50% of the lymphoid tissue. Okay, hey students, okay, fine. So do your exam well, NEET exam well. So we have discussed the microbes in human welfare chapter and also human health and disease. Okay, so these are the 2 chapters for your this week NEET exam. Prepare well. Monday, we can discuss the population interaction. Thank you so much. See you all on Monday. Take care.